These are 9 simple stays on how every graduating YWAMer can maintain their missions of involvement after you leave next week. The first one is to stay single-minded. And so some of you need to stay single-minded in some of your list of things to do yet still that God had been speaking to you in your schools. And I know as you were taking notes in your schools, God was speaking to you about other things, reading a certain book, memorizing a certain verse, sending an email to a certain person, doing something, either spiritual or a practical thing that God put upon your heart, put upon your mind. You wrote it down or maybe did not, but you still remember it. Someone you need to visit or whatever. Don't neglect those things. When you get home and you wake up that first morning after getting home, you can begin immediately working on your list of things to do. And so some of you may be in that same seat where you're going to be in a job somewhere, working somewhere. You might have your desk and your bulletin board and your phone and your computer, whether it's a call center or an administrative center, something, or maybe an accounting, some kind, whatever your job might be. That's not why you're there. You're there as like a on leave YWAMer, but still on the job. Amen.
Yeah.
YWAMer in relationship, but you still have the vision of YWAM in your heart as you're counting those numbers for Jollibee. You get it? You're not there as an accountant. You're there as a missionary. Your job is your co-workers. Your job is your boss. You can't live like that. Turn to your neighbor and say, you can't live like that. You can't do that. You can't do that, friends. Massive people in the churches have unpaid debts. And it's killing us in the Great Commission. Because they can't give a lot of money anymore. Because all their money is tied up in their payments. So we've got to keep all of this together. Live more simply. Just last week I met a guy who changed my tire. A vulcanizer guy in Samar. His English seemed kind of interesting, but he looked like a Filipino. I asked him, you're not Filipino, are you Guam or Hawaii? He says, I'm an American citizen. I go, oh yeah. And he began to tell me his story. He was actually a former Marine.
Wow.
Yeah, from Chicago. And he went to Iraq and he went to Afghanistan. He was on the front lines. He was an infantry soldier and had a lot of experiences. But he got out. They tore his rank off because he had trouble with authority. He wasn't. Little rebellious. Now he's on his third wife with changing tires and fixing flats at a little vulcanizing thing, Tabing Daan, for 100 pesos per flat. $2 he makes for changing one tire. As he was changing my tire, a guy pulled up on a motorcycle with a record book, really organized record accountant type guy. And then in his pocket, there was some writing going on, a little communication, and he gave him 2 10 peso coins, 20 pesos he gave this guy, and then he drove away.
I was wondering,
is that Loto or Wetin or what was that? I wasn't sure. And I asked him, what was all that about? And he says, that's my zapato supplier, my sandals. He buys his sandals from this guy on the motorcycle who has a sandal business. By consignment. He doesn't have to pay cash. The sandals might cost 150 pesos. But he is so kawawa and so in debt and has so mismanaged his life, he can't even buy this former Marine, a US citizen, vulcanizer now. He can't even buy his own slippers anymore for cash. And they're only 150. These are like 60. Hey, I've had 7 years, dude. Amen. Woo! Faithfulness, baby! Amen.
Consignment.
He says, oh, and he justified. He says, I give him 20 pesos every week. And by the time my zapatos, my chinelas are destroyed now, at my payment is finished and I'm ready for a fresh pair.
Aww.
So he has changed his whole lifestyle, 2020, 2020, 2020, 2020, and when they're wallana, he gets another pair, 2020, all over again. I can't believe that could be God's will. You need to make some steps to stay in shape, huh? I know some of you have been doing some exercise, you've had a hard outreach, well, the Natahan people were pretty out of shape when they arrived in Panay, but we helped them for 5 days. You can't do that long term. I remember a particular person once, I know there's many, but this person was so big now, they couldn't even go on outreach. They could not join the YWAM outreach because they could not get into jeepneys. They could not get out of a jeepney. They couldn't get in a taxi. They could not get in my coaster or out of my coaster. They just could not function as a normal person in the Philippines on a normal outreach. There's no way this person could like sleep on the floor, or they could not even fit on a normal toilet. You can't do that. You can't go into all the world like that. You can't go into the innermost Salaol tribes and the Bondoks and the... Amen. You can hardly go from here to Rojas Boulevard without maraming pawisin. Do you agree? Amen?
Amen.
So, you know, you need to make steps to stay in shape, so that you are a happy, excited, clear conscience, full of energy, enthusiastic person. Amen.
Amen.
Because if you're not in shape, you're not happy deep down inside. You don't like your life the way it is. And so, you might be smiling, but really you don't like certain things. I mean, we all like it when we're in shape, don't we?
Yes.
We take special pictures of ourselves. When we come home from outreach, you know, we take special photos because we know it's only going to be like that for 1 month. You know, we do these things to each other because we know intuitively and we like it when we are in shape. And so let us continue to make steps towards this type of a lifestyle so that we always like ourselves. Amen. So that we have no shame.
Even the typical four-year program, the typical four-year college program is not really, it's really a bad way to learn. Because you learn all of your life. And learning should be your whole life, not just 4 years, not just 6 months. But it's a career of learning. So stay in training all of your life. And so you learn, and then you apply it. And when you run out, you learn some more. And then you apply it some more. So it's a lifetime of YWAM training or other trainings. While you're waiting for the bigger goal, you're applying yourself where you are. This is essential. And some of you, I'm convinced, if you can inspire yourself or allow yourself to be inspired, I think a lot of you, in your financial needs as well, things might come together for you better if you apply this better when you're at home, serving where you are. You can do that. Amen. You can start your own seminars. You can organize your own worship seminar, your own plumb line seminar, your evangelistic outreach to the bar areas on Friday nights. You can organize whatever you want to organize. It's in your hands to do. Nobody's stopping you except you. Are you enough to be a self-initiator type person, or you're going to die? You will be a shipwrecked statistic within months. You are the leader. You will start it, and you will lead it, and you will pay for it.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
You just do it. Nobody's going to do it for you. Don't wait for your pastor.
youth leader, don't wait for the worship director. You do it. You start it. You pioneer it. You engineer it. You design it. You make the vision statement. Or with some of your friends, of course, that have like-mindedness. So some of you, while you're waiting to go, you can mobilize the church.